So the take-home message here is autism, clearly environmental influences are much greater than the genetic, that we need more money to address the increases in autism, and particularly at this time in sequestration. We want to make certain that the environmental opportunities of environmental investigation aren't overlooked because of funding. And lastly, when you go back to your offices and start looking ahead at the recertification for the Combating Autism Act in 2014, that we have that appropriate oversight to make certain that we have money going into the environmental side of autism. At this point, we'd like to take some questions. So if you're from, we're going to do it in this work, staff and Congress, media, and those in attendance. So if you have a question, please raise your hand, identify yourself, and we're at your disposal.
I think that we have to have a very open mind. I do think there's been a very singular focus on vaccines, maybe at the expense of the wide range of environmental factors that I think are out there. And I think focusing all the energy in one place may be not the best strategy. And I think that's what the papers may take things and sort of take them out, a little bit out of context or exaggerate certain aspects of what we say. I think this is an area. I think the questions about vaccines have not been fully answered. I think some of the questions have been answered and others have not been answered. But generally speaking, no stone should be left unturned in figuring out what's going on with each and every child. And as I pointed out, probably in any one child there are multiple factors, and some of them may be more easily tackled than others. Some of them may be easier to modify than others. But there are a lot of open questions. That's on you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Just a quick question on comparison. So, obviously we focus a lot on the United States here. Other countries, particularly the EU, what does their funding look like right now for autism research, that type of stuff? Are they setting similar priorities, that type of thing? Do we have any knowledge of that?
Good question without an answer.
I'm sorry, I'm not aware of what they're funding.
Okay.
If you get any information for you, if you want to leave a card,
yeah, that'd be great.
Personally, would like to answer that.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry I was late, so maybe you covered this, but when you were looking at your environmental causes, it seemed to me that you were looking prenatally only and not in the first postnatal period.
The nutritional study was actually prenatal and preconception. The air pollution study has covered also, it was looking at around the time of birth, including late pregnancy and first year of the child's life. So both of those were related to child development. Sometimes it's hard to tease apart the different time periods. For instance, in the air pollution case, many people are, you know, living pretty much in the same area, so you have to have a lot more people to compare where were they living in that, you know, after birth versus after birth.
I had another question about your methodology too. Are you using some of the newer research methodologies that allow you to look at the multifactorial causes?
Okay. Right. So we adjusted for other things when we were looking at each factor, and we were adjusting for educational status, which is associated with getting a diagnosis, but not necessarily with having a child with autism. More educated parents, you know, they're more aggressive generally in searching out to get the right diagnosis for their child and to get the child in their treatment. Sometimes they have may have more resources to be able to navigate our rather complex medical and educational and behavioral system that we have.
I have children with autism. They're also very sick. They have GI disease. I don't know if they want to talk pediatric gastroenterologist. Recently, I was diagnosed with mitochondrial disease.